Ladies and gentlemen, welcome you all after the lunch break. We will now start with our next session. I would request our Director General, Mr. P. Roy, to welcome Mr. Bharat Vaklu and call him to the dais.
Friends, welcome back to our post-lunch session, the most difficult one. I think Mr. Vaklu has a steep task ahead of him. The slope is slippery post-lunch, but knowing that he is an excellent speaker, I'm sure that he will receive your attention. Mr. Bharat Vaklu, a brief word of introduction. Former President, Resident Director of the Tata Group and currently an independent advisor, Mr. Vaklu joined Tata Steel in 1986 and served the company in a variety of various functions, notably as head of Total Quality, Divisional Manager of Technical Training, Senior Divisional Manager of Corporate Relations, Head of E-Commerce, Chief of Tata Steel's extensive supply chain. He has been instrumental in the creation and deployment of the precursor to the Tata Group's GRDQV model. He is also the General Secretary of the Foundation for Restoration of National Values, that word was missing, and authored the book Total Quality, Excellence Through Organization-Wide Transformation. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together to welcome Mr. Bharat Vaklu.
Mr. Roy, I will be speaking from down there and will come to the lectern only to advance the slides. Is that okay with you? And of course, with pleasure. And also, I realize that's a wonderful way to keep the audience awake, be right in the middle of them and make sure they don't get to sleep. Okay, yes. No, it's okay. I prefer it myself. Thank you very much. Okay, so thank you, Mr. Roy, ladies and gentlemen. Great pleasure to be here. I want to start by acknowledging that this document, the National Voluntary Guidelines for the Social, Environmental and Economic Responsibilities of Business, this document would not have been created but for the support of the Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry. And I want to specially thank Mr. Roy here, Mr. P. Roy, and all of you and your companies that actually played an active part in the creation of the document. Now, you might be saying, those of you who may not know how that happened, this document was actually, you know, syndicated in a sense with all of you when it was being written. And in that sense, this document, the NVGs as it is now known, and which was released by the Government of India in 2011, has taken in inputs from all of you and represents, in that sense, the voice of the people of corporate India. So thank you very much. A big round of applause for all of you here today. Now, I would like to be speaking today. In fact, I have an hour, so what we'll do is I'll speak for a while and then take your questions, because this is a topic, as Dr. Chatterjee has very lucidly explained, this is really a transformative moment before Indian industry. This is not something that, you know, you can consider as one of the other rules that figure in the Companies Act. This is truly going to change the way Indian leaders look at themselves and their companies and their relationship with other stakeholders. And to that extent, this is going to be truly transformative. And I must compliment Dr. Chatterjee for a lucid presentation about Section 135, which, as you will see, is a subset of what we are going to be discussing. So, to start with, I want us all to focus on life. I know this is not a philosophical discussion, but let's not forget that we are on planet Earth to be alive. How many of you want to, you know, God forbid, you know, not be alive? Anybody wants to raise hand? No, I'm sure nobody does want that. We want to be alive, and we want, therefore, that whatever sustains life has got to be something which we give primacy to. It's not as if, you know, you do something ignoring the fact that each one of us as human beings has a deep-seated desire to be alive, to be happy, to be joyful, to be, you know, involved in a way that is spiritually exhilarating and uplifting. So when I talk about sustaining life, what I'm saying is that we as human beings have five specific aspirations. And this is not only true about people who are here, but if you go across the globe, you will find that people will have these five aspirations. They want to be doing something which will give them economic sustenance. They want to be doing something that will improve the quality of their life. They also want to be making sure that the thing which keeps us alive, clean water, clean air, food, the forests and the beautiful gifts of nature, those are kept healthy and pristine. And finally, people also want social justice. How many people would like only a few people to become extremely powerful or very rich at the cost of millions of others? I'm sure there's nobody like that sitting in this beautiful room. And finally, let's not forget that we are all spiritual beings having a human experience, and therefore spiritual fulfillment, living our lives in a loving, happy, joyful way with compassion, forgiveness. These are important things to us. And therefore, if these are the five aspirational requirements for all human beings, how in the world can you run an enterprise that does not take care of all this? And that, ladies and gentlemen, is my premise to you today. You cannot possibly run an enterprise if you ignore these five very fundamental human aspirations across the globe. And that is why the National Voluntary Guidelines are critical, because they really address these five issues. And I'll explain to you how. Now, if you look at all these five aspirations, you will notice that they are extremely interconnected. You can't have one without the other. Can you possibly have economic development in isolation? You cannot have that, because your efforts at creating wealth will impact the environment, or it might impact the quality of life, or it might impact social justice, or it might even create working places which are not sufficiently appropriate for human beings. So the interconnectedness of these aspirations requires that we have got to be continuously focusing on all of them together. Would you agree with this? After all, if we want to create an ambience where the five aspirations of every human being, every living being on this planet has to be upheld, then these have to look together. Now, a little short question. Who is responsible for environmental sustainability? Name an agency. Businesses? Yes. Even human communities? Okay. Who is responsible for, let's say, social justice? All of us, in a sense. Businesses as well. Governments also. Economic development, multiple players. Improving the quality of life, again, multiple players. So the point I'm trying to make is that these interconnected aspirations have multiple process owners who are often diverse and who don't talk to each other. And that is a bit of a problem. So, so the implications of the interconnectedness are that you may want to do one thing alone, but you cannot possibly dealing yourself from the other four. And if you have to therefore augment one thing because you're responsible for it, like a business, you want to be doing economic activity in a meaningful way, you have to factor in the impact that you have on the other four areas if you really want to be running an enterprise that is truly life-affirming, that is connected to life. Also, stakeholders who are likely to be impacted by what you do, they need to be involved in the process of how you would like to mitigate their concerns. And the point that Dr. Chatterjee made this morning about how do you decide what you want to do, that's where engagement with stakeholders becomes a very, very critical part of the overall process. And finally, because there are process owners and players for each of these five distinct aspects, all of them have to work in tandem. And that is exactly what the NDGs do. But before I get to the NDGs, one other point. I want to share with you what is known as the 1-10-10,000 rule. What the 1-10-10,000 rule says is that, you know, if you truly approach the running of your enterprise in a life-affirming, sustainable manner, where CSR is a part of that larger picture, then even a rupee spent in a specifically oriented, focused, planned way, designed to alleviate suffering and mitigating adverse impacts of business, will have far greater impact than 10,000 rupees spent without your mind in your business or without any consideration for the impacts. And that's what Dr. Chatterjee said this morning when he said, this is not, spending money is not about giving largesse or doing it in an unplanned fashion. It has to be project driven. It has to be aligned with sustainability and your life affirming processes, for which even if you spend rupees 10, it will buttress your overarching. So, ladies and gentlemen, the point I'm starting off with is that businesses cannot be against life. And no one will say this to you as clearly as I'm saying it, because unfortunately there are few people in the corporate sector who can call themselves philosophers. I happen to be one of those few people whose hair has become grey just focusing on this. And I was fortunate to have worked with Tata for 30 years. They made it easier to be like this. So the point I'm trying to make is that it is important for businesses to be life-affirming, to sustain life, to be sustainable in all that they do, because otherwise they will not be creating wealth without a great deal of misery at the same time. And nobody wants that. And not just nobody wants it, today everybody is watching. There is so much information in the public domain that even if you try to hide, you cannot hide. The press is extremely vigilant. Your regulators are vigilant. The general public is vigilant. So whom are you going to deceive and for how long? So the point I'm trying to make therefore is that this is critical, and businesses are a very, very important player in this whole process, and they impact almost every single aspect of the five aspirations that we spoke about. Think about it, right from having a workplace that is spiritually uplifting for everybody, to social justice, making sure that women and men and Dalits and everybody else are given equal weightage and treatment, not discriminating on the basis of gender or caste and things like that, which is unfortunate, but it happens. So all the way to economic development, to improving the quality of life, to improving the environmental sustainability, all these things can be controlled and managed and enhanced by corporates that focus on sustainability and therefore which focus on the national voluntary guidelines, of which what Dr. Chatterjee said this morning is the CSR part is a very, very critical component of that overarching dimension. Let's take a minute to reflect on all this. Is this something that you all agree with, or am I speaking a language which you don't agree with? How many of you are aligned with this thought process? Everybody? Can you see a raise, a show of hands, please?
Yeah, sure.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. And I'm not surprised. The Bengal Chamber, I just shared with them that the Bengal Chamber gave us very, very valuable inputs in the closure process to the NDGs, because we'd come here in 2010 for a meeting with all the members. So it's really not surprising that you all agree with all this. Okay, so businesses being a very, very critical part of this whole process, so what the next question therefore is, what must businesses do? You know, businesses first of all have to understand the 1-10-10,000 rule. Unfortunately, we don't have too many business leaders who still understand this. That means they give short shrift to planning, they give short shrift to mitigating the adverse impacts of what they do, because it is much easier to do an ex post facto, you know, spending of money. I'm sorry, we are living in an era where you cannot afford to be a spendthrift when it comes to resources, either natural or man-made. You have got to be smart, you've got to be conscientious. And therefore, I would like to say that business leaders, businesses as a whole, driven by forward-looking, proactive leaders, have got to understand that they have to plan and design systems for responsible business. And responsibility, as you can imagine, means being in a position where you affirm those five fundamental aspirations of all people. Number two, when you do that, what outcomes will be aligned with the five aspirations? Number two, when you do that, or you wish for that, then you create robust short-term and long-term internal processes. Because one thing is certain, Dr. Chatterjee has given you an extraordinary perspective on the CSR processes. But CSR isn't the only thing. That's one of millions of processes the company needs to pursue. And that's why establishing and deploying internal processes for compliance, for achievement of whatever you wish to do, whether it's R&R or even safe product manufacturing and whatever else you might have in mind, that has to be done. Then adherence to a balanced and interconnected wholesome economic development model, which is clear vision of meeting aspirations. Again, a reinforcement of that point. And finally, the mitigation of adverse externalities and the negative impact on stakeholders. This has to be consciously thought of. It has to be a part and parcel of the way you do business. When that happens, and only when this happens, would a company then be completely ready to focus on not just spending money at the end of what they do, but focusing on how they make money in the first place. So what I'm trying to say now is that if you look at CSR only as a thing to be done, where you spend money just for the sake of compliance, you got it all wrong. This is not about just spending money, it's about really rethinking your business, making it life-affirming, making it aligned with the five aspirations, and making sure that you determine how your company is making its surplus. Supposing your company is making surpluses by defrauding people, as many companies have done, not just in Kolkata, but around the country, in Kolkata as well. We have a few cases. So if you make your money like that, what good is it? There are millions of people who are crying right now, saying, "Hamara paisa lut gaya. We have been robbed. Dhokha ho gaya humse." And not just here, everywhere in the country you have scams happening. So if you do not focus on how the business is making its money, you have lost it. You have lost the connection with life. And in the NVG, you will see that the first principle is about precisely that, and we'll come to it. Secondly, if you don't take into account the adverse impacts of your business upfront in the design stage and mitigation stage, you may spend all the money under CSR and legitimately, and the government may still give you a good chit, but the government obviously will find out at some stage, but until that time, you will be doing a lot of damage. Let me give you an example. A company is supposed to operate with one bore well in a region where water is scarce, groundwater is scarce. They very clandestinely dig 6 bore wells. And because of the excess water that they have, they are able to reduce the price of the stuff that they make. They make good profits, they spend on CSR, everybody is happy. Until somebody says, but hey, why have the incidence of drought in this region increased? Why are families having more arsenic poisoning now? It turns out that the drawing out of this excess water has increased the concentration of arsenic. It may have given the company a fraudulent right to make profits, but can you mitigate the suffering of the people that emanates from this fraudulent activity by giving, say, even 1,000 crores as CSR in the end? Not at all. So we've got to appreciate this connectedness. Businesses have got to be doing things right from the very go of their enterprise, from the very start of their business. So therefore, my submission is, before we get into the NBGs specifically, is that these are the points that you have to keep in mind as we talk about the responsibilities of business and of CSR. Okay? So let's move on now to the second part, which is, this is of course just a reaffirmation of what I just said. Now part two, and I will spend a few minutes now on the MBGs. Now, in the light of what I have just said, I am very, very happy to say that the government of India, which has been showing a great deal of concern for the points that I have just elucidated, came out with a document in 2009, which was supposed to have been CSR guidelines at that time, but which we were supposed to then put our heads together and refine that. And I had the privilege of being appointed the chairman of the drafting committee. And the drafting committee worked with a bunch of excellent professionals, of which Neha and a few other people are here. And we then worked on those guidelines, incorporating all these concepts. And we came up with the National Voluntary Guidelines on the Social, Environmental and Economic Responsibilities of Business. So this document is the document that we created. Now, why is it voluntary? It is voluntary because this is a document which, if anybody refuses to go by, that person is committing suicide. That business is committing suicide. I told you at the very beginning that, look, the choice to be alive, to be happy, to be joyful is yours. If you reject this, you are actually saying to everybody, everyone in the world, that I am not for a life performing business. And let me tell you frankly, ladies and gentlemen, that this may, today, maybe nobody can enforce this, but tomorrow your investors will start asking you, are you following these guidelines? If you say, no, this is all bunkum, as has been said by many, then let me tell you frankly, the investors who know, the discerning investors will say, okay, in that case, you won't get the money, so you won't get the fund you want. My friend Malcolm is here. He interacts with a lot of investors, and I'm sure he must be hearing this language. Do you, Malcolm? Maybe not as much yet, but you will. Investors will start asking you, how are you deploying your funds? How are you putting your money together? Is your business having any adverse impacts? Are you doing things in the way prescribed in these 9 principles or not? And if the answer is yes, we are on that track, we're moving towards it, we're also sensitive to the needs of our stakeholders, we're spending on CSR, then they will listen to you and they will talk to you in a language which will be good for your business. Otherwise, please mark my words. In another 3 years, investors will charge a premium from borrowers who do not comply with this. Put it down in writing, and then you can say that these are prophetic words from Mr. Babu. Because that's the way it's happening. I'm telling you frankly, not just in India, but around the globe. People are concerned. And the fact is that businesses are waking up and they say, my God, we can't do this anymore. We've got to wake up. How many of you are aware that the American food industry is coming under the scanner in a very, very big way? Because, you know, the American food industry, with all its size and everything, has been focusing on putting things like, you know, corn syrup into everything. And that has serious health problems. And people are saying, why are you giving us stuff which is not good for us? You're not a life-affirming company. And that's why a lot of companies in America which are truly aligned with this, they are standing up in the minds of customers, in the minds of investors, and people are buying more from them. So that is the fundamental idea behind the NVGs. And therefore, let's take a quick look and see what the NVGs say. First and foremost, the NVGs covers 9 distinct areas. This is a diagrammatic representation. Starting off with the left, the southwest corner, where the focus is on ethics. And I said at the very beginning that this, the NVGs, actually start with ethics, which is principle number 1, because no business can be termed a life-affirming business if it is using fraudulent means to make its business services. And I'm very, very proud and happy to say that, having been part of the Tatas for over 30 years, this was something that became absolutely second nature within the company with everybody, because that's how we wish to do business. So moving on in a clockwise manner, you come to the second box, which is life cycle. Life cycle meaning you cannot produce a product or even a service that does not meet the requirements of your customers through the life cycle of the product. That means it has to be safe and usable and fit to use throughout its life cycle. It is no good if it deteriorates and you don't tell the customer that. It's no good if it's unsafe after a few months. So life cycle safety, life cycle disposal. You know, today there's a big concern around the world around electronic waste disposal. And a company has to think through these things. They may use resources to make a product, but how do you dispose it off? Today, in many advanced countries, you actually have to resend the old stuff back again in a pouch given by the company. And that's not a gesture of goodwill or whatever, it's because it's important. How do you deal with a product through its life cycle? How do you dispose of the stuff which is toxic to society, to the environment? You know, and the other day, Vasuji, I was, while hearing the Prime Minister speak from Redfort, he talked about cleanliness, it struck me that as part of our orientation towards the NVGs and CSR, we must make sure that companies are told that if you do not tell people how to get rid of the litter that your products create, you're going to be, you know, given a black spot or something. See, everywhere you look in India, there's